How cool is this? It's the coolest situation ever, right? The coolest experiencing ever, right? Why? Because what you put into it is what you get out of it. That has a lot to do with it. Also, we are on point here right now. Big time. It is go time now. Really, really, really go time. And we are here together, walking together in the wow, sharing this go time, which is really the best time there's ever been in this world. Actually, it really is. Now, what do we need to hear? And the answer is we don't need to hear anything. But pragmatically, we do need to hear, because of our continuity fear, we do need to hear that we don't need to hear anything. All right? Is that clear? Easy, right? Easy. And that's pretty much the whole of it. You know, that's it. We don't need to be liberated from anything. We don't even have any needs, including the need to be liberated. But we do need to hear that we don't have the need to be liberated from any need until we actually can accept this. Actually, our continuity fear is completely evaporated. Then we won't even have that one final, one pragmatic, temporary pragmatic need. We do have this temporary pragmatic need and a temporary problem, the continuity fear problem. We're so used to believing we have needs. What is this need we have? We believe we need to be greater than God. That's the need we think we have. That's what we believe because we have this foolish, silly whim that we need to be greater than God. This is a need we think we have. So we're trying to do that. We're trying to do that. And this is why all this suffering program, we put it in place. We put it in place because we feel this is somehow going to generate extra will, so that we'll have the will then to be greater than the will of God. All based on the belief we have some need to do this. And where did this belief come from? We made it up. We made it up out of nothing. We made it up. We said, oh yes, we have this. We need to do this. Reality doesn't have any needs at all. Reality doesn't even need to be real. It has no needs. It is real. It is real. It has no need to be real. No need to sustain, become. You know, isness is unopposed. It's unopposed. So there are no needs, not even the need to be real. Truth doesn't need to be true. It is true. So this is the essential non-dual teachings. The overall context of what I do here is, you could say it is Jesus and A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words, etc. That this sets the overall context, I would say. Now, within this context, there's definite influences from Longchenpa, Ramana Maharshi, and Sri Sri Anandamayi. Those three, I'm aware that stylistically, I have those three influences put into this overall context of A Course in Miracles. And so this is what it is, and it is very, very clearly non-dual. And non-dualism being presented has to be pragmatic. And what is pragmatic? The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is perfectly pragmatic. So also we would say the influence of the Holy Spirit permeates everything here because of the pragmatism. Okay, we do have a continuity fear. We do have to work at this gradually. We do need to manage our success. We do need to do full stop in the wow and establish, in order to establish a new norm. We do need to work towards accepting that we don't have any need to accept anything. We need, you know, we need to hear that we don't have any needs. So we need to work gradually towards that. This is the pragmatism of the Holy Spirit. We were not locked into an idealistic fixation here. The overall context is perfectly non-dual. But to reach the acceptance of that, to bring ourselves to acceptance of this, which really means evaporating the continuity fear, we have to practice. Practice, 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 practice. There is no secret. Practice is the secret. Everyday practice is the secret. And this will automatically produce success, and then we need to manage our success. It will automatically produce a new norm. We need to get familiar with the new norm. Okay, all of this will automatically take place when we practice. Otherwise, there is no path. I mean, you don't say, well, there's a path, but it doesn't bring any success. Then there is no path to success at all there. So, of course, when we talk about a path to accepting that we don't have any needs at all, we don't have the need to be greater than God, then quiet. Then quiet. Then all is quiet. We have to bring ourselves to that acceptance bit by bit by bit, and we have to have success along that path. And we have to manage our success. We have to manage our success, and this is what takes the discipline. Easy to have success, very difficult to manage it. It requires constant attention, really. We must not allow the elation we experience from glimpsing the fact that we can be free of this hideous, so imaginary need of having a greater will than God. We see, oh, I don't have to do that. I can see it. Well, this produces elation in us. I mean, it's like we've been imprisoned. We believe we've been stuck in prison. We believe the stuckness is forever in this hideous empathy training program of suffering, trying to think, oh, this unborn will that we're trying to get to germinate, this seed, this need seed, it's suffering so terrible because we can't germinate it. So we need to empathize with this hideous suffering so that will produce more will in us so we can get it to germinate and extend. And so we're empathizing with what we imagine to be the terrible suffering of this unborn, this unextended need, which doesn't exist. It's just mad wishful thinking. We don't need to suffer from need. We have no need to suffer from need, to suffer at all. We don't need this training program of suffering, but we're so used to it. We do need a training program to deal with this familiarity problem, continuity problem. We just can't drop what we're so used to it that we think is essential and just gone forever, without clearly understanding why we would be choosing this. So we can't use just an effort of will to, kaboom, and it's all gone. Because we have to clearly be able to choose. And in order to clearly choose, we have to be able to see the two alternatives very clearly, make a meaningful choice between the two. So these are the ABCs, but they're so important that they bear repeating constantly. I repeat them to myself constantly. I'm always going over this, because to forget any of this is to run the risk of backsliding and displacing this elation onto the world, and then you end up pursuing objects in the world. You end up pursuing the world because you think that's where the elation is, not within me, but it's out there. So ideally, we don't displace the elation at all. But pragmatically, there's a certain degree of displacement. We want to minimize it. So we practice full stop in the wow and just let this reverberation dissipate, just sitting here. We're committed to non-action. We're committed to not taking any action as we practice. Practicing is the most sacred activity there is. It's the highest activity in this world. Nothing should interfere with it. And we must make a commitment to take no action as we're practicing. We're committed to non-action. We're just sitting here. I don't care if Jesus appears in front of me and says, come with me. I'm saying, Jesus, I'm busy. I'm practicing. Plain and simple. Okay. You get the idea. So our commitment has to be, ferocious in this way. It has to be very adamant. I am not going to take any action at all unless pragmatically, the house is on fire or something, then, you call the fire department or something, but it's like that. So if there's some interruption and you have to deal with it, then you just deal with it and stay calm, just matter of fact, deal with it, go right back like nothing happened. We get right back in the no action zone. It's like that. Sure. So we'd be very, very pragmatic here. Super pragmatic. Now, the fact is that in this, what's going on in the world right now is epical. It's truly epic. It's truly epic. And so it's a blessing for us to be here. and experience this pressure and intensity so that we can, when the going gets tough, the tough can get going. You see, this is a benefit to us, actually. Great benefit. So don't curse the world. Thank the world. Say, thank you, world, for being so terrible. You know, this is a big help for me. Really. Not that I want you to be terrible, but the fact is you are. So it's, I'm seeing it as glass half full. I try to always see glasses half full. Thank you so much for being so absolutely wretched, you know, in your severe, you know, fear program, which is designed to generate this empathy program. It's designed to generate extra will, which we think will then be this, you know, will then give birth to this new will, which is greater than God, which is a new creation, a fixated creation, separate creation. So we're trying to generate some extra will through this fear and suffering and misery and death and all this stuff we imagine is taking place to us. So it's really not taking place to us at all. We're not being touched by it at all. But like in a dream, we have dream figures and all this stuff happens to the dream figure. We wake up and say, oh, nothing really happened to the dreamer at all. But we are dreaming a dream of appearances and suffering and misery for the purpose of generating this empathy, trying to empathize with something wanted to be born, you know, and created but can't be, and it's being held back. So, oh, you know, it's dying a million deaths. It's suffering. It's, oh. This is the empathy training program, and this is what the ego wants for us. And the ego claims this is our salvation, because the ego believes that only by being giving birth to this new will that's greater than God will we be saved, will we be happy. This is what the ego believes. So the ego puts us, you know, is the like an advisor that we have projected to give us this advice, and it advises us to keep going with this. And this is what, you know, this in hindsight, this is what the ego has had my life trying to do. And really it continually says, oh, I'm going to show up, and then doesn't show up. And it causes just this extreme suffering in me. You know, all these promises, great promises. Oh, you're going to come across Jesus, you know. Well, Jesus doesn't show up. You're going to come across something so helpful. It doesn't happen. And what it's trying to do is it's trying to get me to empathize with this imaginary need we have, need seed, of, you see, it's trying to get me to empathize, say, okay, that's how this need feels, because it's not able to extend itself. And so now you know how terrible it feels. Therefore, you should be able to galvanize extra will to make it happen. This is the whole purpose of this nonsense here. And I've been, you know, keel-hauled through this to an extreme extent, so much so that I've had to understand what is going on. I have to recognize what is going on. This is the ego's game that it's been playing. It, you know, it always promises something in the future that's going to show up, and it doesn't show up. And that is not to say that nothing won't show up in the future. Some experiencing, of course, will continue to be happening. Maybe some of it good, but the ego plays with our, as I say, it's like being left at the altar, that the, you know, there's a marriage supposed to take place. Now everyone's there, and everyone spent so much money flown in from long direction, and you know, the bride doesn't show up or the groom doesn't show up. You're left at the altar, standing at the altar. They never show. And then, oh, you're just so mortified by this. It just creates the most severe mortification. And then, you know, the excuses come. Well, you know, I just, whatever. And then you say, but next time I'll be there. And so you say, oh, great, I get a chance of redemption. So the whole thing, you do it over again, they don't show up again. I've been through this thousands of times, really. And every time you just feel absolutely mortified. You know, you promise, oh, it was great, nothing happens. What's going on? It's the ego who's trying to get us to empathize with this imaginary need seed. So this is how it feels. We keep saying we're going to get the will to germinate it, and it never happens. So how do you think that it feels, you know? But really, there's nothing there that's feeling anything at all. There's no need there at all. It's totally imaginary. So we don't need to empathize with what could never exist, which has nothing, doesn't exist. We don't need to empathize with nothing at all. There's no suffering taking place. And this idle whim that there's some need that God didn't create. There is no such need to be greater than God. So there isn't anything to empathize with. There's no need to empathize with at all. We don't need to suffer. We don't need to be left hanging at the altar. None of these experiences of suffering and misery are necessary for us at all. No, not necessary for anyone. And the ego tells us, well, if you don't do it, then that'll double up the burden on someone else, because we have to generate. That is absolutely not true. There's no one has any need whatsoever to try and germinate this imaginary need seed. No one. And no one ever will. So by giving up, by realizing this, we're not putting any extra burden on anyone at all. Any suffering they feel is they're still believing that there's this need, and then that's between them and their beliefs. Yeah, it's not our fault at all. So again, my own mistakes were made because I was, my projections tricked me into this. The ego's very tricky, and saying, oh, you've got to get prepared because this great situation is going to happen, and if you don't help out, nobody will be helped out. It's so important. So you know, I. The way it was presented to me was like it was this great spiritual opportunity. I have to do this. And so I threw everything I could into it. Nothing happened. I was left up a creek without a paddle, to say the least. And this went on and 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 on. It's like the Tibetan Buddhist story about the master asked his disciple to build a stone house, and he builds it. And then the master says, well, that's great, did a great job, but I just realized it's in the wrong place, so it needs to be over there. And so every time he moves all the stones and builds a new house, the devotee, the master comes up with a different excuse. He says, no, it needs to be moved. And this goes on and on and on and on. And finally, the disciple says, hey, wait a minute, you know, I have got to understand what's going on here. Otherwise, this is just going to go on forever. And so it forces you to really, really, really buckle down like this. And eventually he said he saw, you know, what this whole thing was all about. And then the master says, yeah, that's the ego. You see, that's what the ego is doing for you. And I was accelerating it and helping bring it to light. But it'll do this forever, forever, if you let it. Because there is no extra will that we have. We don't need to add any will to our will. Our will is perfect. Our will is perfect. We can never add any will to our will. It's perfect will already. I mean, you can't add anything to perfection. It's impossible. You can't make it more perfect. Let's put it this way. You can have overflowingness, but you can't make it more perfect. So the idea that we can make a greater will through empathizing with imaginary suffering of this ungerminated seed is nonsense. It's futile. It's completely futile. There's no seed to germinate. There's no way we can produce extra will. And no matter how much we suffer, it will never have the slightest bit effective in this. It's all useless. It's all much ado about nothing. And so, this is easy enough to say, and easy enough to hear, and yet the wow is like, wow, this is great, I like this, I like hearing this. And it's like jogging. You start out and you feel like, wow, I feel like lead, you know, let me just do as little as possible here. And then the next day you keep doing it, and then, you know, and you keep at it, you keep at it, you keep at it. And finally, amazingly, you get around the circuit, you know, and you feel like, well, that wasn't difficult at all. That wasn't very difficult. This is a good feeling, you know, when you do this. So it is a workout here. Absolutely is a workout. You must come with this notion that I must not shame myself by quitting a workout, you know. It's like jogging and you decide, oh, I just got to walk, you know. No, slow your jogging down, but keep jogging. And I'm very good at this. I never go into a walk. I say, got to keep. Even though it's very slow, I am going to keep this notion that got to keep jogging, not walking. So there has to be this determination that I'm going to use my true will to recognize I don't need anything other than my true will. You know, I don't need to add anything to it. And our familiarity keeps pulling us back into, you know, trying to generate more will through torture and suffering and fear and terror and ersatz pleasure, you know, which is really just more suffering, actually. This world is nothing but suffering. It's nothing but impermanence and suffering. And even, you know, even the stuff we think is pleasurable is suffering, actually. Terrible suffering. Special relationship, terrible suffering there. Jesus says it's the worst. I believe him. Absolutely, yeah. It's horrible. But you can make lemonade out of lemons. And we have to do that here. This place is so horrible. We're so used to it. What can we do except make lemonade out of lemons? Got to. And this is a pragmatic. This is where the Holy Spirit comes in. Very pragmatic. Without losing sight of the goal at all. Abidance. In recognizing we have no needs at all. Abidance in accepting and recognizing acceptance that we have no needs at all. No one has any needs. Okay. Abidance in that, at the same time, accepting also pragmatically, we will keep pretending as if we had needs. You know, we will still eat, you know. This, I don't mean, you know, that it extends to everything needs, actually. We don't need to believe we have needs. So abidance is seeing clearly that we don't need to believe that we have needs. There's nothing wrong with believing it. It's just not true in the slightest bit. So we don't need to, you know, buy into it or believe it at all. But we honor our creativity that is associated with this vast play of neediness, you know, this vast play of suffering, really. We honor our creativity. There's the intermediate step. But we can abide in clear recognition. Absolutely we can. And this is the goal here. This is the goal. We don't need to abide in knowing, but we can abide in clear recognition. Very simple. It's simple to the pianist. I mean, the song is easy for them, right? But you're trying to figure out, well, how are they playing that? Well, you're never going to figure out how a piano player plays something until you actually learn to play piano yourself. And then you'll say, oh, that's easy. I can do that, too. It's like, look, watch a guitar player do. He's like, how are they doing? I got no idea. I can never figure it out. But if I actually get a guitar and start working on it, then say, oh, I can do that, too. I can do that. Now I understand. But just trying to figure it out, you know, is not really possible. So trying to figure out, well, why is this so easy to say? You cannot figure that out. It's only in having great sympathetic listening, you know, great sympathy for listening and hearing it, which leads to great discipline. Can you give rise to this wow? And this wow reaction, and you start glimpsing your freedom, and then you just say, wow. I'm elated. Let me not displace this anywhere. Let me not take any action or plans on this or anything. Let me just experience this. By doing this, it becomes easier and easier and easier and easier and easier. And then you yourself will say, oh, you know, this is all obvious to me. It's not difficult anymore. But the success comes from constantly emphasizing the basics of managing success. Success comes from constantly focusing on managing success and always being aware, where am I at? Am I asserting truth? Am I in the full stop in the wow, in the wowness? Or am I working on flipping the script here, flipping the script of going over, you know, mentally going over, how can I look at this in a different perspective, working on a different perspective? And then you're glimpsing a different perspective and say, okay, now I'm going to assert this perspective. I can, I will, I am, I already am. And then that leads back to the wow. So, and then you say, oh my gosh, I'm having success. I need to just let this elation permeate me and do nothing about it. Do not displace it on sex, drugs, and rock and roll music. You know, do not displace it on any of that or anything else. The bell rings. Just sit there and let the bell, let the reverberations die down. It's like that. Imagine there's a huge bell in front of you, and suddenly it just gets, you know, the bell gets rung really strongly, and you're just like, wow. You just feel the reverberations just going through you. It just, you know, wow. Just don't move. Be committed to not moving at all, not doing anything. Gradually, that bell reverberations will die down. And it will seem to go on and on subtly within us, right? But it smooths out and smooths out and smooths out. Don't jump up when the bell rings. Oh my gosh, I gotta go do something. I gotta run. I gotta do. This is a, oh, what do I do? What do I do? No, I said, be committed. I'm going to just be like a statue here. I'm not going to react in the slightest bit. I'm a statue. Great Sri Sri Anandamayama. When she would sit still, she'd be like a statue. People would think she's just a marble statue. All intention of doing anything gone. When her parents would say, look, the parents had to go in to the marketplace or something. They wanted her to stay at a certain place. They would tell her, we want you to stay, just stay still right here. Don't move from here. Don't move from here. So she would sit there and be absolute stillness. No difference between a stone statue. And people would start saying, what is this? You know, this person is frozen in a stone statue or what? And they came back and they said, okay. And they said, why were you like a statue? She says, well, you told me don't move. Be still. So I obeyed. Perfect obedience. I obeyed. It's like a statue. No will, self-will, I don't have a need to do anything. No need. We don't have a need to do anything in particular at all. We absolutely do not have any such need. So when that bell rings, be like that statue. Just be still. Continue to be still. I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to allow this to die down and get used to it. And then next time it rings, I'll say, oh, hardly bothers me at all. I mean, I'm used to it. You can actually get very used to that. And then the bell can be rung even louder. You know, and each time you establish a new norm, it can be rung even stronger until finally the final ringing of the bell is no ringing at all. And somehow the bell becomes absolutely still. And that's the strongest ringing of all. Ultimately, we realize there's absolutely nothing that can ring that bell at all. There isn't even a bell. So ultimately, this is nice to conjecture about. But in the meantime, we just keep practicing. Don't try to grasp that. You know, you can glimpse it. Just glimpse it and say, oh, yeah, okay. Okay, I can see that, but don't try to fixate on that. Don't try to fixate on that there's no fixation. We just see that there's no fixation. We glimpse it and say, okay, wow. Neither advancing towards it nor retreating away from it. Wow is not a fixation. You still have an openness. It's neither nor-ness. Both and neither nor. Cold day today. Really, we're not used to this. Everybody was freaking out. Really breezy, cold wind whipping around everything. I say, what is this? It's a lot nicer this evening, though. So we're going very quickly, right? Very intensely. So that in itself is a wow. Just keeping up, you should say to yourself, oh my gosh, I can keep up with this? Wow, that's huge. Our just ability to listen to all this and say, I'm still standing, you know, I'm still here, the bell is being rung, wow, this is huge success. We're never taught to recognize our success in this world, are we? Except along egoic lines. We're never taught to recognize our spiritual progress, never. Has anyone ever teach us this? So we're like incompetence at it, actually. We really are. Bumbling incompetence. Incompetence. It's the words are always awkward, aren't they? This is why we have to have humor around words, really. No matter what we say, no matter who is saying it, word there's always an awkwardness when words are being used, concepts, expressions, always. So having a little humor and laugh and always realize, hey, dispels the awkwardness. We're realizing, hey, of course this is very awkward, but have some fun with it. Let's not be too overly serious. Like, you must get the right words, I try to get the right words, but it's still awkward because everything's open to interpretation. Words are really meaningless, actually. All symbols are arbitrary. We assign arbitrary meaning to symbols. There's no such thing as symbol in itself having its own meaning that doesn't exist. Doesn't exist. It's all arbitrary. So, of course, everyone will have a different shade of meaning to whatever is being said here. No two of us are getting the same picture of what's being said. Absolutely not. And so the differences of the awkwardness arise. We dispel it, with gentle humor. We all realize that, hey, we're stumbling around in the dark here for sure, and yet it's something we must do. And gradually, we're stumbling towards recognition, abidance, and recognizing there are no needs. No needs whatsoever. Abidance in that recognition. We're stumbling towards that. Now, I know I'm getting close, but I'm still stumbling. Words always make you feel like you're farther away than you are because you're stumbling. So full stop on the wow, we go quiet, and we feel the closeness. We feel, wow, I'm getting closer. Just see if we can feel this. I'm getting closer. I really am getting closer. I can realize, I will realize, I am realizing. I am in realization. I can abide, I will abide, I am abiding in realization. There's no such thing as any needs. And pragmatically, the final illusion of needs is to abide, is to recognize that there are no needs, the recognition. Beyond that is just knowing what is. That's all. It's not knowing that we don't need needs. It's just knowing what is. See, reality doesn't need to know that there are no needs. Reality just is what it is, and there is no other. I hope someday to enable, those who want to go somewhere and have a little talk and work on this more, intensely. Yeah, if that's possible. I don't know if that's going to ever be possible or not, or if that's helpful or not, but perhaps it might be more intense that way, which would at some point be helpful. Keep in mind, my perspective about all teachers, including Jesus, is they're our friends. They walk together, side by side. They walk beside us. They're our friends. We're equal to them. They just temporarily seem to be greater than us because we have this continuity fear dance, and we still think that we have a need to be greater than God. So we're still trying to suffer in order to empathize with and generate more will, and so they seem, oh, they seem so great, but that they're just exactly like the same way we are, actually, in spirit. There's no difference at all. They're not to be worshipped. They're not to be idolized. We're not to have awe towards them at all. Okay, Jesus is not returning as a Messiah figure. Okay, guaranteed. He's already back, and he said, "I'm back here to relate with you as a friend." That's all he said. That's all he said. And I got it. I heard it. This guy said, "Okay, sounds good to me." He's not, the idea of this Messiah, Jesus, Messiah figure, Savior, Messiah figure coming back, it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. That would just exacerbate a lot of the problems that came up in the first place. All right, the idolization, the worshiping, the awe, all of this stuff. Oh, we're just these little human beings. Jesus, you're this divine son of God. Oh, you know, this is not true. We are all the divine sons of God. There's the divine sonship. There's one divine sonship, one oneness, one spiritual family. And we are all members in perfect standing of this one spiritual family. And we always will remain. There's no way we can lose this spiritual standing at all. It's impossible. What is love? Well, here, pragmatically, we have to speak pragmatically. It's compassion, which means effective means, leads to effective means to help evaporate the continuity fear. That's what love is, how love is experienced here. Pragmatically, we just can't say, I love you, I love you, I love you. You know, well, the continuity fear remains. You know, it remains. It's a very severe obstacle. And we have to have effective means to evaporate it, and effective means to manage our success in evaporating it. The more we evaporate, the more success we realize. And we say, wow, what do I do with all the success? This is just, I'm so elated. And I'm very elated by the success I'm having. And so it's difficult to, you know, just keep going. It's always difficult on the path, because the further we get, the more elation arises. And don't bother using drugs to generate artificial elation. We have to experience genuine elation in order to manage genuine success. Okay. Many try to force the issue through drugs and say, well, I'm feeling elated. I feel so high, you know. Okay, now how do I manage that? But they feel frightened because they can't really manage it while they're on the drugs. And so it actually creates a very negative spiral away from success on the spiritual path. Away from success, that is right. It's the genuine elation we have to experience from genuine effective means so that we can genuinely learn how to manage this genuine elation. And this genuine elation is way beyond anything that drugs can ever produce in any of us. In abiding in the vision of oneness, in experiencing the vision of oneness, which I have been fortunate enough to have experienced, the elation is just... You know, I can't really describe it. Really, it's beyond words. It's cosmic elation. I mean, it's beyond cosmic elation. It's total. It's never ending elation. It is just, you know, it's all elation. And there's nothing but elation. Just there's no confusion. There's no fear. It's gone. And so this is such a tremendous success. You know that. We have to keep working towards managing our success and establishing this as the new norm. Drugs can never get you to this genuine vision of oneness in a genuine way like this. So, shun drugs. Absolutely shun all drugs. It's a false path. It makes you think that you're cheating, you know, getting to the head of the line quickly through some expedient like that, when in fact you're actually losing ground, going in a negative spiral. Ultimately, is what happens. And of course, we're all in such a hurry. It's easy to fall prey to drug pushers. They say, "Hey, man, you're real spiritual, man. You know, I got something that really help you on the path. You know, wow, you could check this out. It really is going to blow your mind. It'll make you see oneness and love and peace and all this stuff." And you know, and those who are really in a hurry, I got to help the world. I got to help the world. Then they're vulnerable to this sort of the drug pushers like this. So in order to speed up, slow down, manage your success. Every step, it'll keep managing success. And as you get better and better and better at that, greater and greater glimpses will arise. And greater elation will arise. And just say, oh, wow, this is tremendous. Wow, I really am going to be free of this horrible empathy training program of suffering. I'm going to be free of this forever. imagine the elation. I mean, we cannot imagine it. It's just, and we start welling up and we say, oh, how am I going to, you know, what do I do? What do I just sit there quietly, full stop in the wow. Let the bell be rung. You don't have to do anything about the bell. It'll calm down. It'll calm down. Just give it, be patient. Someone jogging. Yeah. It helps. It helps. Jogging does help. It does help. I'm experiencing this. It does help. Flexibility, mobility, just feeling competent and stuff. It does help. As long as we don't overdo it. It's interesting. I rarely see anyone jogging anymore. Rarely. It's all changed. It's all now people walking their dogs, especially women walking their dogs. Women used to be jogging a lot. Now they're all walking their dogs. Rarely do I see joggers anymore. It's really, really changed. I guess the MD said, hey, jog, it isn't good for you. I talked to this D surgeon and he said, nah, don't jog. It's too much impact. Well, If you overdo it, it's like anything. But, you know, there's ways to lessen impact. Just don't go running down hills, boom, 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 boom. You know, just keep it smooth. You don't have to. It's not that impactful. Certainly, it's great for cardio. Tones the whole system up. But you don't. You don't really get exercise walking your dog, not cardio, not really. So the spiritual path of success is tough. It's tough, it's for the tough ones, really. If you're doing it, you're tough. And then acknowledge it, it's a wow. Wow, I really am very tough. To keep doing it, you know, it's no let up, because we keep having success, and then we have to keep managing it, and then the elation, and avoid it being misplaced, and that struggling with that, and being patient, and persevering, and using their will in the right way, it just, you know, it doesn't let up, it's like running a marathon. You get halfway there and you realize, wow, this is tough. But just imagine how it feels when you start getting close to the finish line. So I'm going to give everyone an appreciation of this, of getting close to the finish line. What, you know, what is it like? Well, it's very compelling. It's very wowish. There's a lot of elation arising. But it's not overwhelming anything at all. But you start seeing the finish line and you say, I'm getting close. I'm really getting close. You say, great, that's really great. And you become more determined. You become, you know, very determined. Very determined. And still very serious. Now, I know this is my final life here, as far as believing that I need a life, okay? But I also know that from here, I'll dwell in the death-free realms. Death-free realm. I don't have to go back to immediately straight to formlessness. No, there's this intermediate step, intermediate realm I can go to. And I could appear here again if I don't need to, if out of compassion to help with effective means, I could, absolutely. Nothing says I can't. I'm free. We're all free. So, but as far as believing that I need to show up here, there's some need based on this need to germinate this artificial need. I need empathy training. No. I'm going to be through with that. Absolutely finished with it. And I would say, well, it's about time. Enough's enough here. I mean, I went through so much suffering this life. I said, I got to figure this out. That's it. The ego thought I had the capability of generating this extra will, and said, you're the one that can do it. And so it put me through this insane torture and suffering, mental suffering, thinking that I'd be able to generate this extra will. And I realized it's impossible. You cannot do it. And the ego cursed me, you know, up and down and every which way, as just the worst person ever, the most damnable person ever, because I gave up. I said, ego, it's not possible. I see it's literally impossible. It's futile. And the ego, again, was just all over me. So, you know, he says, you're the one that could do it, and you didn't do it, and you've damned everybody else due to eternal damnation. And, you know, on and on and on. It was the most ruthless guilt trip possible. It almost killed me. You know, it was so terrible. The guilt trip. And thank God for the grace for the Holy Spirit to say, hey, don't worry about the ego. The ego doesn't know what it's talking about. It says, you're going to be fine. You're going to be liberated from this nonsense. I guarantee it. Just work at it. It's a done deal. Without that, there's no way I would have survived the ego's, you know, hostility toward me. But the overall momentum of all of that kept playing out. You know, that this idea of suffering can generate extra will. Being under the gun so severely, you know, is just will generate this needed extra will. It doesn't matter how much will we generate, it can never change the will of God. So, you know, it's meaningless. Is it extra? Is it not extra? Whatever we say about it, how we define our efforts, they don't get anywhere as far as changing God's will. That's all a zero. So, great times are coming up for us. As the fan of all this previous suffering program that the ego put us all under, put me under, slows down more and more and more. It's already turned off. I turned it off back in 1978, but this fan has been gradually slowing down. So as it gets, it reaches a certain point where it's so slow, then you can see, you can follow the blade of the fan. Oh, I see, it's not, you know, it's not solid, it's just these fan blades. And there's a sudden perspective shift. You know, when you watch a ceiling fan slow down, and you say, I can't quite know how many blades are, I can't tell how many blades, and suddenly you say, oh, there's three blades, or oh, there's four, I can see them. When that happens, there's a perspective shift. So my fan has been slowing down here, and it's getting close to that perspective shift. I know that it is. So, you know, it will happen. You can't really force it to happen. These habits that we've had, these false beliefs, Vedanta calls us samskaras or something, Ramana calls us samskaras, something, a term like that. These habits, this beliefs, this familiarity. Even when we make a decision, okay, I know this is bogus, and I know I can get free of it. There's a momentum of familiarity there that takes quite some time to slow down. So I'm not torturing myself quite so badly these days, as far as being, I'm still hideously under the gun of seeming circumstances, but it does. I don't dwell on it so much. It doesn't get to me. I keep saying, hey, that is going to change. That will change. Because I have no needs at all, so I don't need to be, you can say I don't need to be wealthy. That is true, right? But nor do I need to not be wealthy. I don't need to be poor either. I don't need to be with money, nor do I need to be without it. You see? So being without it for so long, my whole life, it just feeling this hideous fear of, oh my gosh, what happens if I run out of money? And it's constant, immediate possibility every single moment of my day. It, like, I drive, what if I get a traffic ticket? I can't pay the traffic ticket. I have to rely on others my whole life just to keep me going financially. I can't pay the traffic ticket. So I'm I'm driving very carefully, and I'm worried, you know, it's always worried, it's always fearful, it's always suffering. This is all designed to cause me to suffer terribly. The whole life was designed to cause me to suffer so terribly by the ego that I could generate this extra will. And then the Holy Spirit came to my rescue, and I said, Holy Spirit, it's impossible. And the Holy Spirit said, you're right, it's impossible. And I saw what's going on, and the Holy Spirit says, "That's you saw the truth. So now we just need to evaporate the continuity fear, and everything will be perfect. You'll be very happy. So I'm, you know, working to get out from under that gun, you know, the gun of suffering, the gun of suffering, fear, gun of fear, yeah. It's very, very terrible. But we all feel this to some extent. It's just my case has been very severe. I went to the store today. I had to buy something. And I needed to pay cash. So I've got everything I needed. And they rang it up. It was $28 and such cents. I looked at my wallet. I had $29. That's it. And so I gave all my money to there, and that's it. You know, I don't have any more, really, as far as, you know, I have to ask help for it. And no matter what I do, I work so hard, but it all goes into, you know, medical insurance for helping this, and spend, I don't, nothing left over, under the gun, constantly, I was under terrible credit card expenses, having spent so much money because the ego kept telling me there's this great circumstance coming in the world that I had to prepare for, and so I put everything on credit cards. It kept telling me, no, more, and then I ended up with this hideous debt. I worked that off for, you know, 10 years, and not able to save a penny, and it goes on and on and on and on and on. All, you know, hideous fear. I mean, it's just horrible being in debt. Absolutely horrible. The stress almost killed me. It was so terrible. Couldn't sleep. You know, just. And again, this is like all trying to generate that extra will. Okay, that we believe is the, you know, what we have to do. We need to do this to allow this need to be greater than God to expand as a new creation. This is what it's all about. So when we start recognizing this, we start saying, hey, you know, at some point I'm going to realize I don't need to suffer anymore. You can see it. And you say, whoopee, that's great. It's still not here yet. But it's, you know, the perspective shift, you know, it's on its way. It's on its way. And realizing it, you know, get glimpses of it. Oh, this right there, I see it. Oh, it's elation. But still, it still seems to be in time, space, process, and form, instead of right here, right now. All of now is right here, right now. There's not some now in the future. All now is right now. All now is right now. All now is right now. There's no now. There's no aspect of now that's in the future. All now is right now. We don't have to wait for it. We don't have to wait for the fact that we don't have any needs. It's not like, well, no needs is in the future, but right now we do have needs. If we do need the needs now, but we can eventually get rid of those needs, you know, by fulfilling them or something. No, we don't have any needs to fulfill, actually, in reality. Pragmatically, we need to realize that we don't need needs to fill, but we understand this without any level of confusion. So we don't have any needs to fulfill. So what do we need time, space, process, and form for? We don't need it. We don't need it at all. So it's true. All truth is true right now. It's not that we're making it true. We don't need to fulfill any needs and then say, okay, now I'm free of the needs because I fulfilled the needs. You know, I've satisfied the needs. We don't need to do that. We're free of it. We're not free of needs. There are no needs. There are no needs to be free of. This is a better way to look at it. There are no needs to be free of. So this, I'm feeling a buzz now of the intensity of this. I'm able to, you know, get the intensity going. But it's not too bad. It's a pretty mellow intensity. Shaking a little bit. Maybe because it's cold out here. But no, I could feel, you know, the intensity is good. We always try to, you know, reach a really great intensity. And then get used to ring the bell really well. Really ring the bell. Don't be tepid. Don't be tepid. Don't get a little ding, you know, ding. Ring the bell. Go ahead and really ring the bell. Just don't touch it. Don't touch it. You know, just don't say, you know, here's the bell. It had go. Don't go. All right. Oh, I touched it. I touched it because it mutes it. It mutes it. Oh, I touched it. Or don't go. Just don't go. Oh. Well, you can do that to start with, yeah, but little ding, 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 ding. That's too timid. Ding, ding. No, just say, okay, wham. Wow. See, that's a whole different, they're a whole different vibe. Whole different vibe. You must on the path have the intensity. Must. I've met Jesus many times in quote unquote deep consciousness. There is really no levels of mind at all, but we're imagining there are. So pragmatically, well, you know, there's surface consciousness and then deep consciousness. Well, in deep consciousness, I've met Jesus many times, and basically all he ever said to me was just conveyed a sense of urgency. He says, go faster. Come on, don't delay, don't delay, don't delay. Go faster, faster, faster. That's it, just urgency, urgency, urgency. So he's like ringing my bell, you know, go, 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 go. Whipping the horse, you know, just go, go, go. Don't slow down, more, faster. Work more effectively. Don't slow down. So I was fast-tracked. And when I started to get, well, Jesus, why don't I, you know, get with these people who are not doing so fast and be real kind of tepid and timid? He says, no, 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 not for you, not for you. You're fast-tracked. Go, 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 go. Don't slow down. Don't, well, manage your success, full stop on the wow. But, of course, overall context is go as fast as you can. He says, this is helpful. This will be helpful. Now, the need that we have, the only final temporary need we have, is we need to realize that we don't have any needs. And Jesus says, I need help to help out with this, convey this to everyone, that the only need we have is we need to realize we don't have any needs. So I need help with that. Right? That's part of the tree of this need of hearing that we don't, accepting that we don't have any needs. We need to accept we don't have any needs. Part of that tree is this tree of compassionate help and effective practice. So Jesus says, I need your help. Come on, you know, you're fast tracked. Go, 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 go. He didn't discuss the Course in Miracles with me. You know, that was already written down. So he says, just go faster. Don't get hung up on there's a lot that go very timidly. He says, be more audacious. Come on, faster. I need very audacious teachers who really, really are willing to say what needs to be said. I don't want real timid, hesitant. Well, I'm not sure. Jesus, can I say this? I don't know. I want very adamant teachers, helpers, or friends. I need adamant friends. You can do it. 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 Go, 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 like that. You know, he's like a coach or something, you know. Football coach, come on, you can do it. Running coach, whatever, exercise coach, more, you can lift heavier weights than that. Come on, I know you can do it. I said, Jesus, wow, this is tough. What do you mean it's tough? You want to be lazy, huh? You want to be lazy? I said, no, not me. He said, well, come on, go, 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 go. Go time here. It's go time. No time to lose. Go time. Go time. It is go time. And we should all be waking up this as I have been preaching, beseeching everyone in the world is saying, got to prepare for these times that are coming up, because this massive attempt to generate this extra will through intense suffering, intense fear is upon us. like a voracious white shark. You don't want to be swimming in that ocean. You want to be on the beach. You want to be on the shore. You don't want to be swimming in that. Oh, and the shark is, you know, is hungry. The shark is hungry here in this world now. Very, very hungry. Ravenously hungry. And we got to get out of that particular lagoon, you know. Get out of that lagoon. Get on the boat. We got to get on the boat. So, this huge shift in the world towards trying to generate now the most intense fear possible, the most intense mental torment and anguish possible. It's all the whole ball of wax, anguish. You know, there's mental anguish can be horrible. I've been through it all. It's beyond belief how terrible it is, virtually beyond belief. You just can't, I couldn't believe it. I can't believe this. How am I possibly experiencing this? I just said, I don't know. This is incredible. I had no idea that I could ever experience anything like this. It's so terrible. Anguish. Mental anguish. So I know all of you, no matter how terrible your mental anguish is, believe me, I have been there and abided in that for a long time. I know exactly what it's about. And it can be just beyond belief, right? So the effort in this world now is to bring everyone into this state of horrible mental anguish. This is why the media is just constantly, has been constantly showing victimization. Is the more gruesome, the more they show it. And this produces mental anguish in us. I mean, oh my gosh, you know, it's just, it's to try and generate, empathize with this imaginary need seed to be greater, have a greater will than God, which is unable to do it, and just empathize how terrible it must feel so that we can generate the will to germinate it. That's all it is. There's nothing more to it than that, actually. And there is no such seed. There is no such need. So we don't need to go through this empathy training. We don't need to suffer. And we're actually causing the suffering. We're imagining our own suffering. It's not real at all. It's completely in our own mind. We're just imagining it. But like in a dream, you know how in a dream you can imagine all sorts of terrible feelings, right? And you think it's being caused by the stuff in the dream. But you wake up and realize, oh, no, none of it was really causing it at all. I was just having this feeling and then filling in the believing there's these circumstances that were causing it. But really, first came the feeling and then imagining the circumstances that caused it. If you look at dreams carefully, you'll find out this is true. That you saw, oh, I was being chased, I was suffering, and I had this dream of a baseball game recently, and what was it, someone hit this ball, it was going to be a home run, I didn't want to be, and it was caught or something like that, and then I realized the whole thing, I was dreaming this, I was generating all the action in the dream, and all the reactions were coming from me. The fears in the dream weren't doing anything other than they're just a projection of my own desire to feel a certain way. So the desire to feel a certain way comes first, and then the figures in the dream are actually there, but it happens very quickly. It's almost instantaneous, it seems instantaneous. Right, but I saw, no, it's all coming from me. I'm making all this up. All the reactions are actually coming from me, not from any of the dream figures. So nothing is causing how I feel. I'm choosing how I want to feel and then projecting this whole play to make it seems like it's causing this feeling, these feelings. It's not. It's just a trick we're using. So all this suffering, this anguish, we're just desiring to experience this, thinking we need to do so, because this is the way that we only way we can generate this extra will. Yeah, so this is why we're in anguish. No one's actually causing us to be in anguish, actually, in spite of what it appears. And now, granted, it certainly appears, you know, very, very terrible, doesn't it, in the world? Yeah, we're not denying that we're very creative and clever. In deceiving ourselves. We certainly are, and it can get to a point where maybe we're just too clever, you know, as far as, I think people would just say, wow, this is just too much, you know, it's this cleverness, like our creativity is just too much. I that's enough of this. We could get to that point. I wouldn't doubt it at all if we did. It's headed that way. And we just say, well, I need a break from this. Yeah, I need a break. This is... So, you know, what is going to happen ultimately, I don't know for sure, but these are certain parameters we can look at and realize. So we certainly have to go, 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 go. It's go time as far as hearing the truth and getting familiar with it. Familiarity is decisive in pragmatic land here. Familiarity is decisive. This should be a key realization, a mantra that you have. Familiarity is decisive in this pragmatic situation with continuity fear. Intellectualism of just say, well, yeah, I can say that. I can get, that's not decisive. Familiarity is decisive. When it comes to breaking bad habits, familiarity is decisive. Familiarity with good habits is decisive. This is the ultimate tipping point, is familiarity. That's the final weight that's placed on the scale. You can have everything else being weighed, but the final weight is always placed on the scale is always familiarity, and that is what tips the scales one way or the other. When you're more familiar with truth than self-deception, that final weight gets placed on the scale. The scale tips in the direction of abiding in the realization that I don't have any needs at all. I don't need to have needs. No one needs to have needs. The oneness does not need to have the need of not being oneness. It doesn't need to have that. So I still got the juice here. It's important that Jesus wants to have someone who has the juice, who's very adamant. Very adamant. It's like some virtuoso who's getting older but can still play the piano, can still bring it. Some of these virtuosos, they can play into their late ages and they can still bring it. And so I'm not too old to be able to still bring it like this. Fortunately, I had to get back in shape here, at least to feel, you know, feel I'm able to deliver the intensity without wearing out too much. Fortunately, I've been doing that. I'm in a lot better shape. I've been on a juice diet basically for September, October, now half of November, then half of November. 75 days, pretty much a juice diet. Very little solid food. I eat some. What did I eat? I ate some pizza yet last night. Pizza. That's a good way to you know, that's a good solid food to eat, isn't it? I know, a great pizza place, best pizza in the world. And bring some home, and I just eat cold pizza. Throw green Tabasco sauce on it and just eat cold pizza. And it's not very fattening. Actually, pizza doesn't have that many calories, actually. I get vegetarian pizza, some artichoke hearts, some tomatoes, some onions, some mushrooms, and some cheese and the dough, and that's it. And maybe a little tomato sauce. That's pretty much it. Peppers. Maybe there's some peppers on there. That's not very, you know, filling or many carbohydrates. I actually lose weight when I eat pizza. So, pizza and juice, smoothie, 75 days or more, and that's helped, you know, that's helped my overall countenance and health and everything. I mean, it's good, it detox, you might call it detox. I've been on intense detox in this way, but it really hasn't been any problem. And actually, I drink juice protein drinks, you know, the mango protein drinks or something like that. That's got the whey protein or, you know, soy and whey protein in it. And so it does produce a bulk. You know, I don't recommend just like going on like an apple juice diet or orange juice diet. I've done a grapefruit diet before, and that works, but I don't recommend it for too long. It actually can be too severe when you get older. So I recommend having this protein mixed in with your juice drinks. You know, I pour like half a bottle of like an Odwalla protein drink into a juice smoothie, and you know, mix that up. So I'm still getting a lot of nutrition. Yeah, I have like yogurt and walnuts and stuff. So I have a little bit of solid food. Sometimes I have a salad at dinner. Yeah, so it's kind of a mixture, but a lot of fruit smoothies. Have a lot of juice, a lot of fruit smoothies, a lot of liquid diet. Not extreme, you see. I'm not being extreme, which is good. I used to be a little too extreme, and anything I did, I would go for it a little too strongly. but you can reach the same result by being a little more pragmatic, I found out. And it's smoother. It's smoother. I have not really suffered with this, and I'm getting close to having dropped 20 pounds. I keep getting almost there, almost there, almost there. It's really tough. I can eat nothing and still not lose. I can work out. I could eat nothing and I still don't lose hardly any weight. It's amazing. I have to really, really starve myself to lose anything. Go really easy on everything. It would be good in a famine. I do pretty well. I do well in a famine, that is for sure. I'd probably get by and eating bugs would be just fine. Fry up some earthworms. We used to do that when we were kids. Pick up the worms off the lawn and we'd put them some oil in a cast iron frying pan and fry up the worms, and we'd eat some worms. At least I think we did. Or maybe we didn't. It was too gross. I can't remember. But we were thinking, well, what happened if a famine happens? And, eating bugs. Bugs are not that easy to find. Animals can find them. I don't know. Humans aren't necessarily. We're not so good at finding bugs, actually. The wild boar are good. They come to golf courses or grasslands, and they just absolutely plow up the whole surface, and they get all the grubs and bugs that are at nighttime that are coming up to the surface. They just feast on them all night long. They're very good at it. I've seen boars come in and destroy like 3 fairways in a night on a golf course. It's amazing what they can do. Like tractors. Uh-oh, I don't want that song getting on this video. I don't want that song getting on this video because the YouTube will flag it. I got to be careful. Don't get on it. God. Anything ambient, it grabs it like, come on, they got to get better algorithms and say, is this ambient, the ambience of this, is this really copyright infringement if something is so ridiculously ambient and transient like that? Come on. Of course, Google Maps just absolutely is the most terrible program there is. I hate Google Maps. It used to be my favorite program. It used to be so fast and smooth and just worked great. Now it's the worst. I mean, hey, come on, Google, make 2 levels of the maps, please. The slow level that, for whatever reason, you made it so slow it's unusable, or just the fast version, just make, forget about all this bells and whistles that you put in place. It's making it completely unusable. It's so diabolically cumbersome and awkward now, Google Maps. I just dread going into Google Maps. I guess if I could use some other maps that it's just used to it, but it used to be such a great, great program. I loved it. Gosh, not anymore. It's amazing. I mean, that should be one of their most important features is Google Maps. It's very important to a lot of people, and it's like the worst program ever. They're too busy doing other stuff. I guess roboticizing the world or something, whatever it is. Yeah. Putting us in all in driverless cars so they'll be able to control where we go, monitor where we go. Yeah, what do we need to drive for? We don't need our own will. Let's make artificial will. Artificial will germinate that imaginary need seed. You human will, you spiritual will, that's not good enough. You all this suffering, it's not good enough. We're going to program everybody, put everything under artificial intelligence, and this will then dictate to us what our will is and and that will, artificial will, that will succeed. This is their great program now, the great step forward, the great leap forward into the new age, age of Aquarius, the age of artificial intelligence. A stands for artificial, Aquarius, artificial intelligence. This is the dawning of the age of artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence, artificial intelligence. Thank you, Marilyn McCoo. And all your compatriots, fifth dimension. Nah, we don't want that. You see, this is, they're getting it absolutely backwards. They're saying, well, we couldn't do it with there's another way to get the will to really generate the necessary extra will to germinate that imaginary need seed to have a new creation, a fixation, a fixated creation. And that's artificial intelligence, robotics. We're going to get roboticism. We're going to get everything that's driving the cars will drive you out. You'll be able to go to a bar and get, you know, completely whacked. And it'll drive you home. How about that? Isn't that great? You'll be able to take all the drugs you want. You can still drive around. You can, in fact, you'll go bar hopping. It won't be any problem. Yeah. And people say, oh, yeah, I can't wait for that day. You know, really, they do. So it's coming soon, man. I'll just be able to be out of my mind and falling down, passed out, drunk, and would have wiped out. And doesn't matter, man. That automatic car is just going to get me home. So cool. I can't wait for that day. I can say, I don't think so. No. Yeah, no. Yeah, no. Yeah, no to that. Yeah, that's the great age of Aquarius that's coming. Man, everybody's putting a positive spin on it. There's so many out there that, you know, put the spiritual spin on it. There's so many spiritual spin doctors out there. It's an endless swamp of spiritual spin doctors. Say everything's going to be great. It's wonderful. You know, age of Aquarius. Wow, artificial intelligence is going to make it the world. Well, it's all about this will. Okay, we think, well, we don't have to suffer anymore because artificial intelligence will do it for us. Really? Really? What happens when it doesn't do it, you know? Because it won't. What's the suffering going to be like then? Is it going to be worse? The anguish is going to be terrible. Because, of course, the anguish is always there because artificial intelligence will be used to just generate even worse anguish. Actually, think about that. Consider that. Well, how we doing? We're doing very well here. Absolutely, we're doing very well. I'm on point. I've got to be on point. I've got to be. So if I'm not on point, you know, who's going to be on point? Come on. Jesus is relying on me. He's saying, hey, come on. You know, I need you to help me out. Help me out here. Please, please, please. I say, okay. You know, get up there and dance your dance and sing your tune. Do a song and dance. Come on. You got to. So, yeah, well, what else do I got to do, actually? So work it. It's a, you know, struggle in the Silicon Valley here. Talked to a guy recently, played golf with him, and he says, yeah, my hours, 2-hour commute at least in the morning, 2-hour commute, 2-hour, yeah, it's terrible. He says, hideous, hideous, hideous. I said, yeah, I spend all day driving through this stuff. Everybody's saying, I need to hurry up. I got to get that artificial intelligence going so we can get the will going and go and germinate this off imaginary need seed so this finally it finally can, you know, have this new creation that we need to have. We need to have this new creation. God created us specifically to create this new creation. We got to get it done. So we've got to work on this artificial intelligence. We got to go faster, 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 faster. Oh my God, get out of my way. I got to save a second, half a second, a millisecond. Here, I saved a millisecond. I'm awesome. This is really helpful. You know? It's like, wait, where's the civility? Yeah, wait, whoa, slow down. Wait, where's the peace? Where's the love? You know, where's peace and love? Where's the peace and love of the age of Aquarius? Come on, I thought they told us it was all about peace, love, and understanding. Thank you, Downtown Julie Brown, MTV, peace, love, and understanding. Baby, that's all where it's at, huh? Age of Aquarius. Just come to Silicon Valley and you'll find out what it's really about. Then you'll say, uh-oh, this is a complete freak out. These people are nuts. He said they're nuts, completely nuts. They think they're saving the world. Yeah, they think they're saving us from suffering because, you know, don't worry, this artificial intelligence will work. We'll finally have that fixated creation that God needs to have, you know. God needs to no longer be God. Yeah, we'll finally have that. Don't count on it. I'm telling you for sure, don't ever count on that. It will never happen. There's zero possibility it could ever happen. No possibility whatsoever. It's impossible. So this is just a dead end. Artificial intelligence is just a total dead end. Total dead end. It's a non-starter from the very beginning. As is any attempt to generate this will that we don't have, that God did not create us with this will to change our will. Did not grade us that way. Absolutely did not. So we don't have, we can't have that. Don't need it. So for those of you who are hanging in there with all of this, great, this is a great trip. It's a great trip. It was the best trip ever, actually. We're really tripping naturally, actually. We're on this very natural trip. And this trip is the trippiest trip of all, for the real tripsters. You know, we're not hipsters, we're true tripsters, actually. We're really tripsters. I think the word hipster came from being a tripster, actually, maybe. But this is we're the real tripsters. We're not the Mary tripsters, we're the Jesus tripsters, the non-dual tripsters. This non-dual, being a non-dual tripster is quite something. It's quite extraordinary. It's very compelling. But if you don't do it, you don't get it. Just back, you know, the druggies say, hey, man, you don't know what the high is like, man. You can't relate to this. Yeah, that's a fact. We don't want to relate to that, actually. But this, being a non-dual tripster, is, again, you can't relate to this unless you do it. There is no way. There is simply no intellectual way to academics are sure, okay, I think I, you know, academically figured this out, and I understand what it's all about. There's some people here, and they're talking about some non-duality, and they spend some time practicing, and they use these words, they use this word this many times, these are the tags that you can tag it with, and then, okay, now I think I've got a very good picture of what it's all about. They don't have any picture at all. I mean, whatever it is completely flat. You can't understand it unless you do it, unless you experience it. So the ones that are actually experiencing, like, welcome to the trip. Absolutely. No hangover whatsoever. You know, we the full stop and the wow, we do it on purpose. We stop, but there's no hangover. I mean, we understand that there's this, you know, it goes a little bit like this, but there's no crash. We're not crashing at all. It's smooth, you know. We're sprinting then jogging, and we're making very smooth progress. Very smooth progress indeed. So, I don't know what will transpire in the days ahead, but if I know one thing, I'll keep trying to be spot on. That's what I will keep trying to be, no matter what, where I am, what I'm doing, whatever. I will keep trying to deliver the goods here. This is part of my job. This is part of my responsibility. You know, if I sit down at a piano in my previous life, I'm going to play something really good. That's all there is to it. You know, I'm going to bring it. You know, the audience is going to say, hey, you know, this is something else here. I'm not going to just, you know, tinkle the ivories and just perfunctory or something. No, I says this is, I'm gonna blow everyone's mind here. I mean, we're going to have a wow experience here for sure. Because we're tired of suffering. I mean, at that time it was an attempt to generate extra will, of course. Absolutely. But here, it's an attempt to generate the realization, acceptance that we don't need to generate extra will. So that has a tremendous intensity to it also. So we can bring it in this regard. You know, it's just using the old habits and making lemonade out of them. Before it was, I'm going to put on a concert. People are going to walk out of here and they're going to have a whole new will. You know, to get done what this purpose of existence is. They're going to have a whole new will. They're going to be, that's going to generate. So put on this fabulous concert that's got, you know, we feel is really going to do the job. Of course it doesn't. I said, why did I waste all that effort? Well, same reason why everybody wastes all their effort. Self-delusion. You're trying to do the impossible. And ultimately, continuity fear. Thinking we have to keep doing it. That we have to succeed at it, otherwise we'll be annihilated. There won't be any new creation. And we got rid of the old one, so there's nothing for us. You know, this is what we're afraid of. Yes. No caffeine, just juice, protein juice. Head jogging and protein juice and, you know, winding up the motor a little bit. Which is good. We need to wind our motors up a little bit right now, actually. Because it doesn't matter what specifically happens in the world. It's the overall trend is there's an effort, again, to generate this false will, this extra will, this through fear, through suffering, through mental anguish to generate it. So there's a huge push to do that. And the reptilians are here, of course, to help us with that. You know, we invited them here. They're experts at generating mental anguish. And we said, hey, we just can't do it. You know, it's too heavy. I cannot lift this. Oh. And help me. And the reptilians came and said, yeah, we'll help you. I said, oh, thank you very much. We'll give you a spot. Oh, thank you very much. And so they're here to create this extreme mental anguish in the world. And we invite them here. And so, you know, thank them. Say thank you, but no thanks. You know, don't need you. Thanks for, you know, we invited them. They showed up. They're helping us with mental anguish. And we say, well, thanks for being spirit, you know. But we realize that we don't need to do this. It's all much ado about nothing. So you can chill out with us. Let's all chill out together. No more mental anguish. Yeah, they will. They will, too. Yeah. We're all one spiritual family. They're just an appearance that has to, you know, has a mental projection that is functioning in a way to help produce all this mental anguish. But mental anguish is coming. They're experts at what they do. So, you know, give the devil its due, as the saying used to be. And they certainly know how to produce mental anguish. They're certainly programming the deep consciousness of everyone here through television and movies and mass media and social media and the internet and newspapers and all this stuff. But they're experts at programming the subconscious, the deep consciousness, and keeping you just at the superficial. Okay. So you look like you're functioning fine. I'm just the same superficial person I've always been. But what happens is you feel that there is no depth to the mind at all. That the superficial is all there is. And what happens is you give the depth consciousness over to them, to the programmers, so they can use that to produce anguish in you, so this will to try to produce this extra will. And this is what has happened to most people here in the world, which I was so adamant telling people, stop watching television. You're being programmed. Subtly programmed. The Holy Spirit told me I had to stop. And I did. And then that was years ago. And then gradually I went back to just a very, very meager amount, very careful, a little bit of baseball, a little bit of golf, like that. And then this last August, well, beginning of September, end of August, the Holy Spirit said, just cut it out, you know, cut it out pretty much altogether. What? Just stay away, because it's going to be exacerbated, what they're aiming to push you into anguish now. So when you're watching all this television, you're being subtly programmed. They're very good at it. Your subconscious mind, the subconscious, is especially the audio tracks. If you like, go to a different room, have network television on, just crank up the audio, and just spend time just listening to the audio, which is what I've in the situation I've been. I just heard just the audio here in the house. Someone else watching. It's hideous. It's hideous, the audio. And being an expert in music and sound, I can tell you that the audio that they use is profoundly influenced the subconscious mind in programming it to fear. Profoundly. If you just turn off the audio, it loses its impact. These geniuses, you might call them evil geniuses, the anguish geniuses, know how to put all these sound effects and these soundtracks and to make it produce tremendous fear and dread and anguish within us. That the screams, just the soundtrack, so many women screams on all these shows now. It's like, oh, you're hurting me, please don't, you're hurting me. So, you know, it goes on, and the whimpering and pain. This stuff is all programmed subconsciously, and yet we're thinking, no, I'm just watching a movie, I'm just watching television. No, I can turn it off, I turned it off, as if, okay, there's nothing happened. Well, no, all of that subconscious programming is like termiting us and causing us to be afraid to look within, our own mind. We become afraid to look within our own mind, and therefore we only then function superficially and think the whole world is controlling us. You see, we're being controlled by the world instead of realizing it's our mind that is actually doing all of this, and we're just imagining like a dream. We become too afraid to look within. This is what has happened in the world. It's a terrible situation here. I have had a front row seat to all of it. I know exactly how it works, and it's diabolical. But we asked for it in this world. It didn't get forced upon us, actually. So we can also ask to not have it, you see? And that will have to be complied with also. As long as I keep thinking it's been forced upon us, we're stuck with it. But we finally admit, no, we actually asked for all this. This is what we wanted, we desired it, then we're in control. We can say, okay, no, I don't desire it anymore, so I'm not going to be experiencing this anymore. But the fear of looking within through all this terrible, wretched programming that people have been subjected themselves to, this is a very, very big issue. It's the dance of continuity fear in extreme form. And they remain superficial. They can't get out of this superficiality at all. And so they just keep trying to feed this superficiality more and more. Say, I'm not satisfied. I'm not satisfied. Give me more and more and more of the superficiality. Sex, drugs, rock and roll. Come on. You know, food. And I need to keep feeding this superficiality monster, so that I can feel satisfied. But it's never enough. I need more money. I need more things. It's never enough. And they think, oh, God, you're cursing me. You're damning me. Because they think this superficialness is what they are. Because when they try to look within, it's this hideous nightmare. They say, wow, you know, where did that come from? Well, guess what? It came from watching television every day. It came from watching movies all the time. It came from listening to music all the time. It came from subjecting yourself to this nasty, nasty, fear-based programming. That's where it came from. But you can walk it back. You can absolutely walk it back. It's not easy, but hey, it has to be done. So this is what's really happening here. You know, I know these people want Age of Aquarius to be all wonderful, but there are so many, many here in this world. We're not talking about small percentages. We're talking about overwhelming percentages here who have this bifurcation now of the surface and the depth consciousness and are afraid to look within. And you can never solve the problem as long as you refuse to look within. It's not possible. It is absolutely not possible. So we're going more and more in direction of the superficial materiality and then allowing artificial intelligence to run the unsubconscious to produce this terrible anguish and terrible anguish within us. We say, I don't know where it's coming from. I just feel I'm going out of my mind. Give me meds. And everybody's so super medicated to try and produce this extra will to germinate this imaginary need seed to be greater than God. This is the whole thing in a nutshell here. And the one that puts it in a nutshell for us is not nuts. It has to be realized too. You must be a sympathetic listener. It can be put in a nutshell. We're just afraid, like, oh boy, what's going to happen when we put it in a nutshell? Maybe I'll just lose. No. Intermediate step, honoring our creativity. We've used a lot of creativity in this empathy program, suffering program, that we've generating extra will program. We used a ton of creativity. So we love our creativity. So underneath of this all, there's a love of our creativity in all of this, actually. And so we can just experience this, but we don't have to believe that any of this is necessary at all anymore. The feeling of necessity, poof, gone. Nana, my mom would say, I don't need to do anything. I'm just here because you asked me here, but of my own will, I don't need to do anything. So she says, if you don't ask me to do anything, I'll just sit here and turn into an ice statue, a rag doll in the corner. She said, I would be lifeless. I wouldn't do anything at all here. I don't have any desire to do anything. I don't feel any need to do anything in terms of I need to do something in particular. No, I don't. I don't. And when they stopped asking her, she would turn in this rag doll. She's lying in a corner like a corpse. And they'd have to wake her up by saying, okay, please help us out. Please help us out. Can you help us out this way? We want you to help us. And then she'd seem to come back to life. But she says, I'm not saying anything of my own. I'm what you're putting words into my mouth because you need to hear it coming from something that you have faith in. So I never said anything, is basically what she says. Well, but her attitude was there, the attitude was there. The wisdom was there, the attitude was there. The non-neediness was there. You see, the complete clarity that we don't have any needs was there always, as it was with these other teachers, Longchampa, Rama, Harshi, Jesus Christ, etc. We just have a very good record of it in modern times here, but those other ones, also same. They know we don't have any needs. We don't need to be greater than God. There's no need to have any needs. We're perfectly free. How are we doing? Very good. Bringing a lot of energy to this one, this is necessary. I'm trying to, be this way more and more positive, because it's the time we have to be positive, isn't it? Because the other side, the negative, is getting real nasty, and we should have realized. I did realize this was all coming. The Holy Spirit told me, so I'm prepared, and hopefully you're, also getting more and more familiar with positivity here. We don't need to evaluate what has no value, no application to it. Why do we need to evaluate fear, this whole fear program? I don't need to evaluate it. I just need to know it's unnecessary. I need to know that we don't have needs. That's all. No more evaluation. That's as far as evaluation needs to go. I don't need to know what the terrorists are doing and who's suffering, blah, 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 blah. No, that's the fear-based agenda. We don't need it. That's the only evaluation we need to make. So I don't really, I'm not being negative, I'm not responding to, oh yes, something terrible happened, and oh, isn't this awful? It's just the same old. It's just more intense. The intensity's been ratcheted up. We expected it. Come aboard, we're expecting you. The fear agenda. It's coming aboard, the love boat, or the unloved boat. But it's all love underneath anyway. But we were expecting this, so we have prepared for it. And so we're now going super positive. Super, super positive. And keep the humor because of the awkwardness of words. You got to sprinkle it with that. Because I know you're saying like, oh, yeah, I kind of get it, but I'm not sure that the words mean this, or does it mean this, or does it mean that? I can't quite, well, no, you can never quite understand what somebody else is saying because, you don't know what my meaning that I'm ascribing to the words really is, right? And so how can anyone know? You cannot. So you listen sympathetically. And get the gist of it, get the feeling of it, get the overall feeling, positivity of it, get the positivity of it, get the mood of it, get the feeling of it. Yes, we can be positive here. Yes, we can. We don't need to evaluate what has no value. That just breeds confusion. We don't need confusion. We don't need to evaluate what has no value. The belief of an imaginary need, we don't need to evaluate it in depth at all. No depth of evaluation. No, just we don't need it. We don't need the false belief in needs. That's our final answer, final evaluation. And we won the prize. Isn't that great? Come on down, Johnny, and tell them what they've won. You have won an all expenses paid trip to paradise, the death-free realms. I said, wow. This is, confetti, confetti, confetti. Let's have the confetti. Come on. And what's more, you don't have to come back. It can be a permanent vacation, you know. That's even better. That's the big prize. You have won the big prize. A little chilly. I wish it was warmer, 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 warmer. Warm up. I could put a heater here. I'd get in trouble for too much energy, using too much energy. But a nice little heater here would be awesome. I don't know. I'm thinking about it, but plug it in. Yeah, something like that. I may have to do that this winter. I've battled through all the winters before, just frozen out here. But the last four winters have been so mild, it's been completely wonderful. I wasn't much of a problem. But this one is seeming to be a little more intense. And we're headed into a very intense winter, it seems like. Could be very intense in California, around the world. Always, you know, El Nino could be coming. But the fear, the anguish in the world, people, obviously I can tell since this, whatever it is, took place in Paris. People have been different. I can tell everyone's mood is. I can. There's some inner anguish. Is like they're feeling it. They're starting to surface. You know. Well, yeah, duh. That's the intent of it all. But that servicing is not servicing me at all. What's servicing me is bliss, is elation actually. Because I choose it, that's what I chose. I said, I know this is coming, so I was going. We're either going to choose the fear agenda or the bliss agenda, the elation agenda. One of the two. One of the two. That's it. Those are the only agendas there are. It's always been that way. It's just the fear agenda is getting more intense, so people think, oh, this seems like a new agenda. No, it's not. It's the same. It's just more intense. Just more intense. So yeah, it has affected people. It has affected them drastically. Whatever it is that happened, I don't really know. I don't need to know. I don't need to evaluate it. All I know is it's something that struck fear and anguish into people, which is that's same old, same old. It's always been going on here. Doesn't really matter. The form that it takes doesn't really matter. I don't need to evaluate the form that it takes. No, none of us do. Why do we need to evaluate the form of meaninglessness? What is there to evaluate? The evaluation itself is meaningless. I mean, Jesus says, my meaningless thoughts are showing me a meaningless world. Well, that's what he's talking about. We're making these meaningless evaluations of meaningless. That's meaningless because it's meaningless. This fear agenda is completely meaningless. There's no application for it. So it's meaningless. It has no value. So our attempt to evaluate it is confusion. For us, we're confused. I'm not sure. Is this it? Is this it? I'm so confused. This inner confusion is anguish, too. It's part of the anguish. Don't need to evaluate it. Stop evaluating. You feel like, oh, I'm not confused. I'm getting free of confused. I'm feeling elation. I'm feeling bliss. This is great. Of course, in miracles, Jesus said, this is for teachers of God. He says, who's a teacher of God? Anyone who chooses to be. Well, I chose to be. I said, I'm going to be one. So the course was for me. You know, it's for those who choose. It's not actually for everyone right now. It's for those who choose to be teachers of God, and eventually all of us will. But in the short term, it was for those who are really choosing to be teachers of God right now. And the course in miracles said, look, its ultimate goal is that to make itself unnecessary. It's not like I'm had to sit here and, you know, quote a scripture, a paragraph here, a section here, it says right here, oh yeah, let me look at all this, and Jesus says this. I don't have to do that at all. This is all completely spontaneous, you know, just boom, 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 stream of consciousness. I don't need to go look in the book. I haven't remembered anything that, you know, I can, a few little sayings I can pick out of a hat or something, whatever, I don't know, you know, nothing rolls. Threaten, nothing unreal exists. That's a nice one. But no, I'm free of the course, of the structure of it. I'm free of it. I'm free of it. I'm free of it. And this is what Jesus' goal was that. He doesn't want us to be some structured hierarchy religion, teachers that are, you know, set up a new priesthood of all these rituals or whatever. No, not at all. Not at all. He wants us to be free. He wants us to walk beside Jesus wants to walk with him and as friends, as free, we're realizing our freedom. We don't want to get caught in some religious structure again. Jesus, again, I said, is not coming back as Messiah. That's right. He's coming back just as a simple, humble friend. Just a blissful friend. Yeah, a blissful friend. A simple, blissful friend. So, gotta get ready for that. Absolutely. I'm ready. I'm ready. Let's go. It's go time here. It's absolutely go time for us. Right? Is anyone here saying it's not go time? Anyone at all? No, you can tell in the world people are saying, uh-oh. We thought, we hoped. Whoops, it stopped. What happened? It went completely blank. It just stopped. This is really something. I've never had that happen before. Now it's back going again. Wow. That was really something. I don't know. But wow. Maybe that's just showing a shift into darkness right there, and the world is shifting into darkness. So, that's what they wanted. That's what they want to do. But people were hoping that, you know, maybe it won't get so bad. I hope it does go bad. I said, forget about hoping and luck. No, prepare for the worst. Hope for the best and prepare for the worst. Hope for the best and prepare for the worst. So I said, I got to prepare for the worst. Because I believe it's going to happen here. This is what the Holy Spirit has told me is going to happen. I believe it will. And it is happening. It is happening. We have a nightmare. The world has a nightmare on its hands, actually. Okay? We know it. Now we're starting to realize there's nothing that these folks won't do as far as bringing about anguish and fear in the world. There's nothing. There's no parameters at all. Right? And we're saying, oh my gosh. And they don't know an option. You know, they don't have an option. They haven't prepared familiarity with an option to this. So this problem of familiarity, they're running up against this brick wall of familiarity problem, continuity fear problem. It's a very subtle problem. If you don't have it pointed out, you might not see it. You don't understand. Not understand. It's there. It's there, and then they're hitting this wall and say, oh my gosh, we're trapped, we can't get out. Well, it's just familiarity. How could familiarity ultimately trap us? It cannot ultimately. It's actually, as Jesus says, like clouds, it's flimsy, you go right through them, but it looks like real solid and heavy. I can never get through that, you know. It's just an image of a concrete barrier, but the images, when we believe in images, it can seem very powerful to us, and very, you know, but it isn't. It isn't. We can gradually dissolve the seeming solidity of it, you know. And then we realize, oh, there's nothing, no barrier at all, really. It was just all continuity fear is what it was. It doesn't mean a real barrier's there. It's just I was afraid for it not to be there is really what it is. The only solidity this has is our fear of not being solid. We're afraid that there's no barrier, and then, oh my gosh, you know, I don't need needs at all. And what am I going to do with myself? So we're afraid of that, so we keep believing it's all, but it's not. It's just an hallucination, actually. It's a mirage. It's a mirage. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Really, big thanks to Jesus and the Holy Spirit. The only way I'm able to talk this way is because of Jesus and the Holy Spirit. That is the bottom line. And then the helpers, Longchenpa, Ram Maharshi, and Sri Sri Anandamayama, that's the reason I'm able to talk like this. And a shout out to all the great teachers, Buddha and Shankara, etc., 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 that have helped out so much. Otherwise, I couldn't be speaking like this at all. Not even prayer, not even a hope of it, you know. It's not possible. The fear that we have, the cognitive fear, and what we've done to defend against it seems so solid, seems so ominous, seems so difficult, that without all this encouragement and help, we would be too timid to even attempt it, really. We just stay, hey, I gotta be happy with superficiality, and that's it. You know, free sex, drugs, and rock and roll for everybody forever, come on. And that's it, you know. Yeah, without all this help, this is where we'd be at, actually. So all gratitude to those who have helped out. You know, every bit of help helps everyone. Every bit of help helps everyone. And we certainly need this help in realizing, recognizing that we don't have any needs at all. That is the help we truly need, pragmatically, temporarily, until we can accept that we don't have any. We've never had any needs. It's not that we got free of needs. We've never had any needs. It's not that we got liberated from stuckness. We've never been stuck. Okay? This is not the heart of non-duality. Now, I hope someday more will watch these videos, you know. But yeah, you know, what can I say? Even if nobody watched them, I'd still make these videos, because I know everyone is hearing this and experiencing it at the deep consciousness, deep mind, and realize there is no real deep mind. Mind is just one, but we have believed it's bifurcated in very levels to it. There aren't any levels really, but we've imagined there are. So we talk this way. It makes it easier to relate with too, and. So at the deep levels of mind, everyone is hearing this. They know that this is taking place, even if they're not watching the video. This is a fact. So I do it anyway. Everything I do anyway. You know, even though maybe no one would listen to me, I still do it. I've written so many essays, and no one's ever read them. I've done so much videos before I started posting on YouTube. I did so many videos and so much stuff, and nobody ever saw them. Nobody ever saw them. Did this massive amount of work. But I keep doing it because it is registering. It is registering. It is registering with everyone. But you can't really tell that it is. Because they say, well, I can't look there. I can't look there. No, it's too dangerous. I can't look there. Oh, yeah, wow. Can't look within, I can't look within, but it is there, it is there, and it will help long term, it will help out. So don't be afraid to speak the truth, even though nobody is listening. You think, well, nobody's going to pay attention. Well, we're all hearing it in the mind. The mind is experiencing it, actually. So be sure to, in your, you know, express yourself, practice, keep practicing, expressing truth. It becomes easier and easier and easier as you do it. The more you do it, the easier it gets. It's just like learning to play piano. The more you practice, the easier it gets. And be creative, be artistic, be wise, be flexible. You have to keep using excuses to practice. Whatever excuse you can get, it doesn't really matter. You don't have to be some quote-unquote expert in a certain way. Whatever excuse you could find, you know, you see a tree, you say, hey, that tree reminds me I need to practice, then that's great. Whatever you notice in this taking place and you say, oh, I got a reminder from that. Or someone else say, you're crazy, I didn't get a reminder from that. It doesn't matter. It's whatever you use it, want it to be. If you want it to be a reminder, say, oh, I just ordered a sandwich and, oh, that sandwich reminds me I need to practice, you know. This is fine. This is great. This is being a genius. All right? You need to be a spiritual genius. The lettuce in the sandwich. I looked and I saw Jesus in the lettuce. This reminds me of Jesus. Oh, yeah, I need to realize I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit, exactly as God commanded. I need to thank Jesus in gratitude. I need to be recognized, accept Jesus as a friend. Because I saw Jesus in the lettuce, you know. Well, I mean, is Jesus in the lettuce? Well, we had the desire to be reminded, so we projected an impression upon the lettuce. This is being a genius. This is not being crazy. It's being a genius if you use it in the right way. Okay, because these are all images that have no meaning at all. So we can project meaning upon an image and use it in a positive way. Why not? Some people see Jesus everywhere. Why not? It reminds them. It's a motivational thing they do. That's fine. Or not. Whatever. Whatever works. Whatever works. A little moth just landed right here on the computer. I don't know why. But so you could look. You could see that beautiful little moth land. Now it flew off again. And you could say, oh, you know, that reminds me of impermanence. Or something, right? Or or making a full stop on the wow. The little moth reminded me, oh, I need to make a full stop in the wow, because it made a quick little stop here, and then it flew off again. So I said, oh, thank you for the reminder, little moth. Yeah. Now, is that being silly? Not at all. That's being a genius, a spiritual genius. And say, oh, yeah, I need to do full stop in the wow. Thanks for the reminder. It's our own spirit, you know, that is reminding us. It's amazing how it flows when we're willing to let it flow this way. As they say, beauty's in the eye of the beholder, right? Beauty's in the eye of the beholder. Reminders are in the eye of the beholder. Don't argue against it. Everyone has different ways as far as reminding themselves. So just let it be, let it be. I'm trying to be volatile because it's cold out here. My core is starting to chill. How are we doing here? 155. Someone asked me, it's cold today. I said, are you cold? I said, what cold? What do you mean? I love today. I love the weather. It's a beautiful day. It's a fantastic day. I absolutely love the day. And I said, oh, really? I said, yeah, I'm still breathing, right? I mean, as long as I'm breathing, why shouldn't I love the day? It's better than not loving it. It's better than not breathing. You know, come on. Love the day here. It's a beautiful day. It was a gorgeous day. Every day in California is a gorgeous day, Bay Area. Every day. It's been a run. It's been a long run now. Even though it was windy, it was a beautiful wind. It's blowing this beautiful autumn leaves around. The sky was so blue and crisp and clear. And everything just looked so exquisitely beautiful here. Even though it was quite chilly and breezy. So I just said, wow, love today. People said, how are you doing? I said, I'm doing really great today. I'm not just doing great, I'm doing really great. And people ask me how I said, I'm just fantastic. I just feel fantastic. I don't say, I'm okay, how are you? Yeah. Hey, how you doing today? I'm okay, how you doing? I'm okay. No, I say, someone asked me, how you doing? I say, I just actually feel fantastic today. How are you today? I say, the guy kind of like, oh, what? Fantastic. Why you feel fantastic? I feel absolutely fantastic today. This is just the best day. I'm absolutely elated. How do you feel? I'm absolutely elated. Absolutely elated. What are you elated about? Just lack of confusion. You know, I don't have to evaluate what has no meaning. I just realized I don't have to evaluate what has no meaning. So I'm just feeling I'm walking on sunshine. You know, I'm absolutely. Katrina and the Waves. Walking on Sunshine. Great song. I feel like I'm walking on sunshine. I feel I'm walking on air. I just feel elated. What happened? The Giants win the World Series? Well, that was last year. And, you know, every even year. Today was this year was an odd year, so they didn't win. But, no, it's just because I realized I don't have to evaluate what has no value. That isn't that true? It's true. I'm not being flippant at all. People thought I was flippant. I'm not flippant at all, actually. This is absolutely true. I'm elated because confusion has vanished. And why did it vanish? Because I realized I don't need to evaluate what has no value, and therefore there was not this confused struggle to do so. Meaningless struggle. Confusion rises from meaninglessness, actually. Our attempt to ascribe meaning to what has no meaning generates confusion and fear. So that's gone. That's receding. So I feel elated. Absolutely, I feel elated. When's the last time you ask somebody how you feel, and they say, I feel absolutely elated? Probably never. Never here. If the people are on drugs, how do you feel? They look at, hey, are you a narc? You know, you're trying to bust me out. So that's not good. That's not good. That doesn't work, does it? These kids in the park a long time ago, and I was a little bit older, and I was just hanging out. I just wanted to talk, and, you know, just be friendly and, hey, what's happening? What's going on? Well, you know, just I was in that time frame. I was doing just, you know, I didn't have anything to do, and I was just like, hanging out, and they were all on drugs severely, and it's like, they looked at me like, total fear, get out of here. You know, wow, tried to avoid me. I said, what? I think I came back later, next day, or what, later on, I saw him, I said, what happened? Why did you treat me like I was such a pariah, you know? And they said, well, I mean, we thought you were a narc. We thought you were a police. You thought undercover police person to bust us, coming to bust us. And I said, what? I said, yeah. And at that point, I think that's the first time I realized I was getting old. If the young people thought I was a narc, undercover policeman, I must be getting old. I was like devastated. I said, oh my God, I'm not hip anymore. And I really have lost my hipness, you know. And they thought I was a narc. Terrible. Terrible. I said, uh-oh. And I realized maybe, you know, I better just stop trying to hang out with the youth culture and be hip and just forget it, you know. Forget it. It just blew my mind right there. That was the end of it. You can't go back, you know, to your youth. You can't hold on it forever because at some point some of the youth will think that you're a narc. And that's the end of it. Very funny in hindsight. And I saw the humor in it a little bit. Always try to see the humor in your disillusionment. You know, it is kind of funny. The youth don't trust anybody over their age, you know, because they're always doing something illegal. Really, I mean, they're always pushing the boundary somehow. They're always trying to cheat something, you know. They're always trying to find out, how can I get something for free? How can I do this? And so they don't trust anybody that are not their own generation or age group, you know, because they'll give them a pass, you know. They'll give each other a pass. They say, yeah, we do that too, whatever. But the older people, they think, they're out to get us. They're out to bust us. They're out to arrest us. They're out to, you know, cause us trouble because we don't trust them. We don't trust them. Well, that's that same way for every generation, isn't it? But I always hated that, you know, just hated it. Yeah, I love the young people who can relate to older people. You know, there's some trust there. Because they're probably, not trying to do illegal stuff. How's it doing? Ow, reached 2 hours. Cold, I'm getting cold. No excuse, is it? There's no excuses here. No excuses. When it's go time, it means no excuses, plain and simple. No excuses, plain and simple. You go for it. Plain and simple. I'm going for it. Something's coming up big time that I'm going to go for it. I'm going for something. And just don't be crazy about your money, you know, as far as feeling destitute or so indebted you're being crushed by it. That's not a good thing. Whew, I'm doing that again. I mean, I'm going for broke here, actually. I'm again, another going for broke situation. The Holy Spirit, it suggested, though, that I do this. I feel, at least I believe it's the Holy Spirit. The ego can be very clever and has been, you know, brings the goddess in and saying, she said it's okay, so it must be okay with the Holy Spirit. Come on, we're all on the same side here. Well, no, we're not. There's you know, fear and you know, that agenda, the fear agenda is not on the same side of realizing that there's no need for any needs. So the ego and the Holy Spirit are not on the same side, actually. So I hope it's not the ego. But, you know, there's always, you know, we'll see what happens. But I am going all in for sure. Big risk in terms of not having money in the future, definitely. But I fear I'm not going to have it anyway, so why not go for broke right now and see how far we can push things as fast and how far we can push it all here. And just trust that it will work, and I've done the work. And so we'll see what's next. I don't know. Should be fantastic. Should be great, though. Should be great. Has to be great. As long as I have breath, I'll keep on trying to do everything I can do. And trust in the Holy Spirit. God will find a way. God will find a way where there seems to be no way. Tommy Tenney. Is that Tommy Tenney? I think so. No, that's not Tommy Tenney. That's Don Moen. What am I thinking? Tommy Tenney. That's Don Moen. The God will make a way where there seems to be no way. He works in ways we do not see. He will find a way for me. He will be my guide. He will be standing right by my side. Yeah. It's a great song. Don Moen. Don Moen did a lot of really, really good songs. We talk about Christian gospel songs. Don Moen's wonderful. What did Tommy Tenney do? God Chasers. He wrote those some books. God Chasers. Stuff like that. Those are evangelical books. I'm fluent in everything spiritual. I have overall spiritual fluency. I could speak the language of many tribes. It's all good. You have to see the big picture, the big context, the big picture, the big context. Everybody's trying to do their best to get free of this continuity fear. And, you have to get wiser and wiser about managing one's success. The problem is we don't know how to manage our success. We limit our success then, intentionally limit it. And then we try to dress it, package it up to make it seem like, well, this is it. The superficial is all there is. And we just understand that's what's happening. We don't condemn anyone for this superficiality. Don't condemn it. And then, they say, oh, superficial is it, so what's the depth? Well, that's bad. They got to figure out some way to demonize it. It's the continuity dance. Yeah. Continuity fear dance. So we keep evaporating, and look what happens. You're able to be, get freer and freer and freer and freer of it, and not afraid to look within, not afraid to let the elation arise, and the confusion to disappear, and bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. What else do we have to do, other than suffer? Either suffer. Keep investing in suffering, or we can disinvest in suffering. It's all we got to do here. You can't know here. You can't know truth here. Jesus said it's impossible really to stay here and know truth purely in just knowing. So we either are investing in suffering and fear, or we're disinvesting in suffering and fear. That's one way to put it. So we might as well invest in disinvesting in fear. Absolutely. Disinvesting in suffering. It's going to be one or the other. It's going to be one or the other. So pretty easy choice when you see it that way. We get down to homework. It's like, my, I don't want to do my homework. Like a kid, school kid is like, it's always like that. Oh, I got to do more. Oh, wow, I just did a lot yesterday, Yeah, it's a funny thing. I never did any homework in school, but because I had more important homework to do. But I've never missed a day of homework on the spiritual path. My spiritual homework, I've never missed a day. Yeah, I've been like exemplary in this, but in school, I never did any homework. Hardly, bare minimum. And once my parents did weren't overseeing it so much, I didn't do any. I'd get to school as a test. Oh, what's the test on? I didn't even pay attention to what was happening in class. The test today, what's it on? Well, it's the history of the Byzantine between the split with Rome or whatever. And I'd say, oh, where's the book, the history book? And scan. I'd read super fast, and I'd just try to pick out what I thought the questions might be about, and then I'd take the test and, you know, maybe get a C on it or something, or a B. So, in physics, I get an F. I didn't even bother in physics. I just didn't even fill out any of the answers, so I just turned it a blank test. I could put my name on it and turn in blank. Chemistry, too. Chemistry. And then the teacher just shakes your head and says, I don't think this guy's going to be a physicist. Or a chemist. I don't think he's going to be a chemist. I said, look, I'm not going to be a chemist anyway, so, you know, why bother me with these questions? And I was an accelerated program, so they gave me a C minus. That's all they could do. So I got a C minus in those courses. But they said, if we could grade you, we'd flunk you. You know, I says, well, go ahead. And, you know, I wasn't flunk me. I got something more important to do. But no, they were cool. They were cool. Teachers were cool. Really, they didn't bother me. They didn't bother me. Nobody's really bothered me. They're very, you know, not really. There's a lot of stuff I could be, people could come down harsh on me with it, but for some reason they don't. I don't know. I don't know why. They just don't. So, that's very much appreciated. I'll tell you that. The oneness, the one spiritual family very much appreciates the people, the way people have treated me. They have not come down too harsh on me, really. Although, I hope, well, yeah, let's keep that trend going. Absolutely have to. Because something inside must be telling them, hey, you know, maybe this could be helpful at some point, so let me not, you know, burn my bridges here. Let's not burn this bridge. I might be stupid. I might regret it. Well, yeah, that's true. Don't want to burn the bridge to truth, you know, to effective pragmatic practice, you know, in wisdom. Don't want to burn that bridge at all. If we can help it, you know, sometimes I've spoken out, hopefully not too harshly, about some gurus that I thought, you know, might have been problematical in certain ways, so hopefully I was not too harsh, and I try not to go into that anymore, you know. It's just, let's just do our thing the right way, and let it be whatever it was what people asked for anyway, so. Just leave it at that. You know, nothing happens to us against our will at all. And the whole idea of trying to produce some greater will than what we are, we keep thinking that everything's happening to us against our will. So, oh, there must be a greater will out there because I'm being forced. These things are being forced upon me. So that's just the proof. You know, there's the proof. There's this crazy guru forcing all this crazy stuff on me, and that's the proof that there's some stronger will than mine. And yeah, interesting, huh? How we do that. Victimization, it's called. Oh, I'm a victim of something forced. No, we're just trying to convince everybody that there is this stronger will, greater than our own will. There is nothing greater than our own will, actually, because our will is the will of God, actually. It's all one will. The will of God is the only will there is, actually. There's not some separate will. When we say we're spirit, we're not separate from God's will. There's only one will, and that's God's will. We are just a functioning aspect of God's will, spirit. You might say we're the functionality of God's will, like that. But it's all just God's will. There's not, the Trinity doesn't mean there's three different wills, not at all. There's just one will. God's will. It's just they're different. There's the functioning of that will is God, the Spirit, God the Son, God the Spirit, and then the blessing upon that will blessing itself is the Holy Spirit. But it's all God's will, one will, three aspects, three functional aspects to it. One will, three functional aspects. God, the prime creator, God as the will, Son of God as the functioning of the will, the Holy Spirit as the will blessing itself. Okay? That's the Trinity. That's the Trinity. One will, three aspects. So I hope you've enjoyed this. I hope you feel it's been more, it's gone, been something that transcends superficiality in your life, help you transcend the superficiality, help you realize there's more I can see, I can look, I can really see this, I can do it, it's possible, it's possible, it's possible. I'm hearing something, someone saying that they're doing it, it is possible. So, and so hopefully we've gotten this sense of we're not just a superficial consciousness, material consciousness, okay? Not at all. Not at all. Not at all. And the more familiar we get with this, the more beneficial it becomes, the more momentum it becomes. Okay, absolutely, this is true. And I will try to do, I will try to do what I can do going forward, everything I can do going forward. And you know, let the zone be flooded with God's grace right now, right now. Let all of right now be right now, because guess what? It is already right now. All now is already right now. Always has been, always will be. All now is right now. All now is right now. And that's it for this one.